Dead Rising is a game.
Being among the earlier games of the seventh generation, it's pretty damn old, but it exudes a level of quality in its presentation that isn't easy to replicate.
It's fun as heck too, so if you want to watch me talk about it for a little, keep on watching!
Man, that sucked. I gotta redo that.
Huh?
What do you want?
Hungry? It's already that time of the month.
Yeah, I'll feed you after my video.
Jesus Christ, dude, will you relax? You only eat like every 1,000 hours. Why are you so pissy? And you haven't been in a video for almost a year. No one here even knows who you are anymore. Hey, you know what? Fuck you! Why am I even feeding you? It's not like you're my pet. I don't want you hanging around in my closet. Alright, fine. I'll get you some Whataburger after I'm done. Just crawl back in your hole or whatever already, man. I don't have time for this. Which is fitting, considering...
Time is a central aspect of Dead Rising's design.
Did you know time and space are the same thing?
I know this because I have connections. Deep state connections. And we don't gotta talk anymore about that.
You could think of it like there's three spatial dimensions we all exist in, and one temporal dimension we all travel through. A line that goes from the beginning of time out to infinity.
Wait, this isn't making any sense.
Think of it like this. You grow old, you remember the good old days, you die.
But more importantly, Frankel misses cases if you fuck around too much.
As humans, we love simulating those three spatial dimensions to play with spheres and VR,
but practically nobody wants to add time into their gameplay loop or whatever the hell they call it. Probably because it's unintuitive and difficult to implement well.
I mean, even in its own franchise, the Dead Rising games pretty much gave up on the 72-hour system after 2.
Again, probably because it's really hard to do well when your whole campaign is tied to an IRL clock and you want to make that system impactful to the experience and not a throwaway mechanic, then every action you take as a developer has to be approached from this new angle. Where items spawn, how they spawn, the size of the areas, your movement speed, the combat in general, everything has to have an extra 3 layers of thought to fit well and feed into your overarching systems.
Hopefully I'll get this across more in depth with respect to Dead Rising in the next section of this video, but even looking at other time games like Majora's Mask or Outer Wilds or... I honestly can't think of any others. You can see how their gameplay and worlds feed into this idea of using time as a central pillar of design.
Plenty of games have time trials, clocks pasted on one of the corners measuring how fast you're playing, but it takes significantly more to make every part of the experience relate to time in a way that enables novel and interesting gameplay opportunities.
Do I sound like an IGN article yet?
Every game that's done this is revered as a classic, and Dead Rising does this damn well.
All right, sit down, boys and girls, or girl, I think I've only ever had one of you here. Anyway, sit down, gamers, because we're in the meat of it now, and I'm going to have to start throwing some terminology at you.
If you've heard these terms before,
bonus points! And if you haven't, then pretend I made them up and I'm real smart.
So, we have the micro game and the macro game.
The micro game is the moment-to-moment gameplay, basically what you're physically doing at any given point in the game.
I like to think you can describe it as a series of 3-word sentences.
For instance,
in Dead Rising, you kill zombies, you walk around, you fight bosses, you escort people, you pick up things. Fuck, that's 4.
That's Dead Rising's micro game.
The macro game is kind of like the game within the game.
In Dead Rising, it's the time system and the gameplay decisions that the time system informs.
If the micro game was me walking to a store, getting a weapon, saving an idiot, and beating a boss, then the macro game would be my gameplay-informed decisions that led me to all those points.
Why did I go to that store instead of this one? Why'd I take this path instead of another? Why'd I save this idiot now instead of leaving him for later?
In Dead Rising, these decisions are all strategic parts of a plan the game asks you to develop before you've even left the safe house.
A well-planned route through the Willamette Mall satisfies 3 objectives.
It gears you up with all the orange juice and sharp pointy sticks you'll need.
It hits up as many side objectives as possible along the way.
And it gets Frank to his case on time.
Crafting these routes is the macro game, and they'll evolve as time progresses.
As you you learn the locations as strong items, as new enemies spawn, shortcuts unlock. Dead Rising asks that you get familiar with the mall's layout so you can effectively utilize that knowledge in crafting your routes so you ultimately get to where you need to be when you need to be there. The most important objective here is that third one. In fact, without it, this whole idea kind of falls apart. There's no need to actively plan out every step along your way if you have all the time in the world to be fucking around. But that's not why Dead Rising is a good time game. It's a good time game because the macro game penetrates into damn near every constituent aspect of the experience. For example, did you know that one zombie is a fucking joke? These aren't Left 4 Dead zombies. They act more like what you'd expect from a walking sack of actively dissolving meat. So to say, they're slow, weak, and predictable. But zombies rarely come alone. They like to travel in hordes. And Dead Rising does hordes better than any other game of its time. And that's where the geniusness comes in. Zombies in Dead Rising act more akin to obstacles than dangerous enemies in their own right. They have short range, like I said. They're slow, and most weapons kill them in one hit. So it's real easy to slaughter hundreds of them unscathed if you just stand still and take it slow. You can imagine a scenario where this optimal strategy could get real boring, but you quite literally don't have time for that. And it's actually difficult just getting from point A to point B in a reasonable amount of time without getting gummed. Dead Rising has a reputation as a game where you just kill fuck tons of zombies all the time, but in reality, a lot of your gameplay is more about avoiding these fucks whenever possible. And really, just traversing through the mall itself is as much a core part of the moment-to-moment gameplay as killing zombies. You'll find that you end up putting yourself in more danger trying to avoid and run past these fucks when the alternative of clearing yourself a nice safe path through the horde takes up precious time and weapon durability. You can't be running back and forth everywhere to replace your katana or whatever.
That's a good segue into the items, right?
Because they're also tuned towards the macro game. There's all kinds of items to pick up in Dead Rising. It's kind of known for that.
Damn near every loose object in sight is an improvised weapon just waiting to crush bones.
But weapons aren't the only thing you'll be picking up. Healing items like orange juice, apple pies, apple pie and orange juice milkshakes. Human arms, hell, even stat buffs take up a slot in your inventory in the form of magazines you can find all over the
map. Jesus!
Grognard, don't eat that! Quit trying to jump scare me!
God, what was I talking about?
Oh yeah!
You don't have infinite space for all this shit.
Frank starts out with shallow pockets, maybe like 4 or 5 slots for everything you'll need.
As you level up, you'll unlock more space, but you'll constantly be thinking about your inventory and what you're bringing for the next case.
Items respawn every time you reload an area, even the strong ones.
And since Willamette Mall is a surprisingly small place broken up into even smaller plazas, you can imagine how reloading an area to load yourself up with an inventory of chainsaws and protein drinks can present a problem to the balance.
But what balances this is, you guessed it, the fucking time system. It's what limits you from collecting an inventory full of overpowered shit. But to be frank, that's still very much possible. My point is, the way this works, like the rest of Dead Rising's microgame, only makes perfect sense when contextualized within the time system, the macro game.
And let me tell you a secret.
This isn't just how you make a good time game, it's how you make a good game.
When you have an interesting idea, you want to interweave it into as many core parts of the gameplay as possible.
Reference it, make it inseparable, and impactful to the experience as much as you can.
Dead Rising's cohesiveness with this philosophy is what makes it such a classic and genius game.
Dude, come on, that's gross. And I told you not to eat that. Ah, great fuck. Clean this up, man. God, what's up with this guy? He's unruly today.
Actually, I do have one more thing I'd like to touch on. One more aspect of this game that I feel really elevates it from its peers, and that's Dead Rising's presentation. See, it's important to note that this game was made by Capcom, a Japanese company. So you have an Eastern development team making a zombie game based in Colorado.
kind of can't get any more American than that.
And if you're looking, it's real easy to see the Eastern influences. And if you ever felt that the Willamette Mall could fit in the Luminal Space map pack for Gary's Mod, this is probably why.
You ever been in a Middle America mall? Because they're not nearly this nice.
You can tell a Japanese guy designed this because it ain't a two-story, two-lane concrete bunker of capitalism.
Just straight off the bat, there's too many curves here for fuck's sake.
In an American mall, all lines must be straight.
Absolutely zero circumferences.
It's simple math, really. You can't cram nearly as many dollars in a sphere as you can in a cube. Or other similar polygons.
I mean, just look at this park, smack dab in the middle of it all. There's no way we'd sacrifice a solid 80% of our mall square footage. For what? That shit libtards call nature? Man, fuck nature. How am I gonna monetize all this grass?
This place is just oddly cozy and nice to spend time in.
It's got good music, a cool Wild West saloon, and a roller coaster. Hot damn. Who wouldn't want to be trapped here?
It plays a good backdrop to an equally well-presented story. On paper, it's nothing special. Standard zombie flick shit. So standard that I'm not even going to bother doing my story time bit where I go through it step by step. You get the gist of what I like about it just by seeing it. The cinematography is excellent. You could tell whoever blocked these scenes wasn't content with intercut medium shots of people talking. It reminds me of the Hideo Kojima game and its relentless pursuit to make every frame interesting. There's so many different angles and movements the camera makes, and none of them feel odd or slapped on. There's a lot of thought and a real sense of fluidity and motion that goes into choosing where you might place your camera in a scene. And Dead Rising's cutscenes just ooze passion and creativity. I love it!
Dude, are you alright in there?
Shit, I hope he doesn't acquire a taste for human flesh or something.
That'd be mildly terrifying. Where was I?
Even though the production level of these cutscenes is outstanding, like TV level shit, it's the performances that carry this.
It's hard to believe this script was written by some Japanese guy before getting flown overseas to be read by some Yankees.
It's all really well executed. Big props to the voice talent for showing up like they did.
You can also tell the voice actors were doing the mocap too, the way they move, talk, and act all together in the scene.
There's plenty of modern games that seemingly can't do this. Alongside the godlike cinematography, it goes a long way in making Dead Rising one of the most memorable zombie games of its generation. Its characters are cemented in the ethos of gaming, or whatever the fuck you want to call it. So basically, what I'm saying is you should play Dead Rising. It is well worth experiencing, one of the most unique games I've ever played. And not just because it looks and feels unique, but because it weaves and intertwines all these facets of its gameplay to deliver an experience unique to it.
Every individual aspect of Dead Rising by themselves are good, sure, but nothing you would label as a timeless classic. But when you put them all together, the game you get is something special that just can't be replicated. But it can be bought on Steam.
And I'm happy to say, it runs perfectly. We're talking modern resolutions and high frame rates out of the box.
Makes my job easier, because I don't gotta teach you how to install some third-party band-aids.
If I sound like I'm impressed, it's because I am.
And I am because Dead Rising 3 ran at like 23 FPS when I tried to play that on a 1060. I kind of didn't know what to expect, but I'm pleasantly surprised.
And I probably shouldn't be, though. This got remastered for the 7th gen, and I'm pretty sure that's what's on Steam.
But I don't care. At the end of the day, it's nice to have an old game preserved well.
And that's pretty much Dead Rising. It's a fantastic, absolutely quality piece of entertainment that holds a special place in mine and many other people's hearts.
And for 20 bucks, it's hard to say no to this sexy ass beast.
Hey, if you like this sexy ass beast, make sure you like the video and subscribe.
And of course, make sure to comment other old games you think stand up to the test of time.
Anyway,
thanks for watching! Do